probably the most important thing to consider when selecting a surgeon.
So many of my patients come to me and say, am I too old for joint replacement?
And these are important considerations because degrees matter, millimeters matter. When you're putting in a cup in a total hip replacement, we have targets that we're aiming for and exactly how that cup sits in space.
I'm a board certified, fellowship trained hip and knee replacement surgeon.
A hip replacement procedure involves an operation in which the cup-shaped hip socket, or acetabulum, and head and neck of the thigh bone, or femur, are replaced with prosthetic components. The bones of the hip joint experience wear over time, or become damaged from arthritis, fracture, or other conditions, such as bone death due to loss of blood supply. When the cartilage covering the bone surfaces is damaged, the underlying bone becomes irritated and develop spurs and other irregularities, which can cause pain and loss of motion. Your anesthesiologist will determine whether to use regional or general anesthesia. First, the head and neck of the femur are removed in order to provide access to the acetabulum. Next, the damaged cartilage of the acetabulum is removed, and a metal socket is attached via screws or cement. A spacer, made of plastic, ceramic, or metal, is inserted between the prosthetic ball and socket to allow for smooth gliding motion. The bone of the femur is then hollowed out, and the implant stem is cemented or press fit into the bone. Finally, a metal or ceramic ball is used to replace the femoral head.
So in regards to total hip replacement, will a patient do more damage to their hip if they hold off on doing it? You know, the answer is technically yes, more technically, no. What we know is that yes, you just walking on your hip is causing damage. Is that damage going to turn into a harder job for the surgeon or a harder recovery for you? And almost always the answer is no to that. Yes, your hip can catastrophically fail for some reason or another, and that would make the job harder or the recovery harder. But by and large, the longer you wait, the surgery is not technically harder. We do see, though, that there's some considerations you must have. And what we know is if you decondition yourself, or if you get to your joint is so tight that we can't move your hip around, you know, in the knee, it's the range of motion of the knee, that we can't give you all of that back if you wait too long. In the hip, just overall stiffness is a bigger concern. And so we see patients who may become so stiff that it can be a little bit harder to do the surgery. That takes a really long time. And while that can be the case, it's the rare part. I think the bigger considerations you should consider are that the less you do because this hip hurts, you get deconditioned. And if you find yourself not doing as much and your heart becomes less healthy or your lungs become less healthy, and we call this the cardiopulmonary status, if you can't walk a city block, if you can't go up some stairs, then you've made it harder for you to recover. And that's where we try to get those patients into prehabilitation to get them stronger for the surgery. But overall, it's not really that you're damaging the joint more, making our job harder or your life harder. It's that you're creating an ecosystem that's not as healthy and supportive of the surgery, and we may have to get you back on track before surgery. So many of my patients come to me and say, am I too old for joint replacement? That has changed drastically as well. And so what we see is with modern anesthesia techniques, with modern surgical techniques, with better tools, and I joke because my dad's a doctor, that with better surgeons, these surgeries are becoming safer in patients who are more grown up. So if we look now, because we don't have to do general anesthesia, because we don't lose as much blood, because we do the surgery much faster because of better tools and teams and all of that, this is becoming a safer surgery for patients who are in their 80s and even 90s. Next week, I have a patient who is having a knee replacement with me on his 93rd birthday. The most grown-up elective surgery, or the person who is the oldest that I've done an elective surgery on, is in their late 90s. And so we've seen a very large change in the safety of this surgery, allowing us to do it on patients who are more grown up. So what can I do to make myself a better candidate to ensure a successful outcome for hip replacement surgery? I think that this is a very similar idea to knee replacement surgery. It's that we want to make sure that you consider the preoperative factors that can increase your risk of problems. We know that nutrition plays a role in this, and so proper nutrition will ensure that your vitamin E and vitamin D levels are high, that your albumin levels are high, and these have been shown that if they're low, you have an increased risk of problems. Uncontrolled diabetes plays a role in increasing the risk of infection and other problems. And so we want to make sure you have those taken care of before surgery. Optimizing your weight is very important. We know that if your height to weight ratio is above a certain level, you have an increased risk of wound healing complications, infection, and the parts loosening sooner. And then the concept of prehabilitation came out 10 to 15 years ago, where we started to look at the patient and say, what can we do to make them safer before in the musculoskeletal sense? We know that if your muscles are strong and if you can go up a flight of stairs or walk a city block prior to surgery, you're going to improve your chances of recovery after the surgery. So before the surgery, factors that can be modified. We can't modify our age. We can't modify our height very much, but we can modify our nutritional status or diabetes, and those are important to decreasing the risk of complications and ensuring a successful hip replacement.
There are essentially two different ways to achieve fixation with a total hip replacement. One is cemented fixation, in which we actually use bone cement to cement the stem down the canal of the femur and provide initial mechanical fixation. The other option is what we call press fit, in which we actually impact the stem down the canal of the femur, and it has a roughened outer coating that the patient's bone will grow into and provide long-term durable fixation. Both of these modes of fixation have shown durable survivorship in the literature. Usually it's a decision based on the bone quality of the patient. Patients with poorer bone quality, we will often use cemented fixation, versus patients who have better bone quality, we will rely on their own bone to grow in and provide lasting, durable fixation. So really, within the last few years, navigation for total hip or total knee arthroplasty has become increasingly popular among surgeons to optimize outcomes, reduce outliers, basically making the surgery more accurate and more precise. I think the most important thing for a patient to remember is that navigation platforms, whether it's robotics, whether it's computer navigation, whether it's augmented reality or AI driven, they don't do the surgery for you. The surgeon still has to perform the surgery. But what it is, navigation is a tool that allows you to be more accurate when putting those implants in. And these are important considerations because degrees matter, millimeters matter. When you're putting in a cup in a total hip replacement, we have targets that we're aiming for and exactly how that cup sits in space. And if you're off by a couple degrees in one plane or another, it can really affect the outcome of the surgery. And so having a technology, again, whether it's robotics or computer navigation, AI, augmented reality, whatever you call it, that allows you to get that implant in exactly the position you want can be a very powerful tool. Same thing on total knee replacement. Achieving balance in a total knee replacement is something that can be done with the help of a navigation platform. Again, robotics and computer navigation has made great strides in that regard. And so using navigation can definitely make your surgery more accurate, but it is not a panacea for all things in terms of the surgery itself. The surgeon still has to perform the surgery. It's just a very accurate tool to make the surgery better. After a total hip replacement, rehabilitation mostly consists of walking. It's getting up, moving, walking about, gradually venturing out for longer and longer distances. There are some muscle activation exercises that you can undertake with a physical therapist, activating the pelvic girdle, working on the quadriceps and gluteal musculature, but probably the most important aspect of it is simply walking.
So let's talk about physical therapy after hip replacement. I think there's a couple of different things we need to know, and that is that physical therapy after an anterior hip replacement is a little bit different than physical therapy after a posterior hip replacement. Many patients know that the anterior hip replacement is the newer technique. Technically, it's been around since 1947, but it is newer, and it's gained popularity over the last 20 years because of a little bit faster recovery. But there are certain things I don't want my patients to do after anterior hip replacement. I don't want them to do a straight leg raise like Jane Fonda or Richard Simmons might do in their videos, because that can irritate the hip flexor, which is the front side of the hip. With posterior hip replacement, there's a little bit more precautions. I don't want them to try to bend their knee up or get extremes of motion. And so my physical therapy after hip replacement is directed at which approach you had. And less so like the knee, hip replacement physical therapy can be a little more laid back. We know that odds are you're going to get your motion there's a little bit more laxity in the hip in terms of motion. So you should be able to get your motion even without the grueling therapy that you see in knee replacement. So for me, yes, the amount of work that you put in these first 3 months is going to get you back there sooner and is going to set the stage for the rest of your life. But it's not as important as that knee replacement physical therapy. So what are the most important questions you should ask your orthopedic surgeon when considering surgery with that surgeon? You know, from my perspective, I believe that doctors are well-trained. They come out very prepared to take care of patients. But I think it could be important to ask the doctor, what are the approaches that you use? What are the implants that you use? How many of these have you done, and how long have you been doing it? Certainly, when I came out of residency and fellowship and trained at great places, there was a point where I did my first one. And what we know is we've studied those patients who had their first and second and third surgery, or the surgeon had done their first few surgeries, and those patients do great. Certainly, the surgeries get more expeditious or fast as a surgeon does more of these with the same team. But we have looked at early on career surgeons, and they are giving excellent care to patients. But for me, I would ask, how long you been doing it? How many of these do you do? Where do you do the surgery? You know, the government has changed a lot of things in regards to how we can care for our patients and where we care for our patients. Total joint replacement has been named now an outpatient procedure where the patient may be expected to go home the same day or within 24 hours. So I would want to ask my surgeon, what am I going to expect from this surgery? What are your follow-up preferences? And then I think it could be helpful to know who they do it with and how long they've been doing it.